We're now about to go live in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now live.
89.5 WSKB.
From the campus of Westfield State University, this is 89.5 FM, WSKB, Westfield.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Wow. Wowee. Yes, I'm all alone right here by the radio. But my co-host is working on a problem, and I understand totally. He'll be here soon. Take a look at this spring-like setting behind us. Oh, my gosh.
It's not spring-like. It's cold out there.
It is cold. It's very cold out. For all of you guys, January 16th, 2024, welcome. This is not... we are celebrating Martin Luther King Day on January 15th, but we're doing a taping in all transparency, okay?
Making me come in on my day off instead of just getting up in the morning.
Oh, my God. I couldn't believe it, Peter. It's funny. Martin Luther King Day is an important holiday. It's in one way, but it's also like one of those holidays that sort of flies by the boards. If you're a retired person, you kind of forget that there are these Monday holidays.
I just think you're keeping the white man down.
Oh, stop. Oh, my God. Rise up. Holy moly, God help us. But anyway, happy day after Martin Luther King Day to everyone. It's an important holiday in a real sense because it celebrates civil service. And throughout the country, people are thinking this past weekend and yesterday, and I hope today, about what we need to do to make this country a better place. And listening to the words of Martin Luther King really help. And looking at... the work of all those folks who have tried to make America a better place in some way. Am I looking at the right camera?
Yeah, straight out.
Straight out. Oh, okay. All righty. Last week, I spent the entire first hour
because
looking over
here.
Because
you had a Zoom interview. That's why.
Yeah.
Only when you have a Zoom interview do you look at the camera by the TV.
Oh, there is. So, folks out there, when you see me looking over there...
Why are you giving them all the inside baseball stuff?
Well, so that they can write in or they could... Oh, they can't because this is live on tape. So you can't just tell me that I'm looking at the wrong camera.
Right.
But, you know, you're the one in charge, Peter Coles.
Yeah, there's that.
Yeah. Hey, I had an experience. I was even late for the taping. Do you believe that? We tape live.
Oh,
so
big
begin.
Surprise about that.
Oh, I know.
Somebody came in here early, made sure everything was ready to go.
Oh, you're so good. And I even have your songs right here, my song sheet and notes for today, et cetera, et cetera.
Gotcha.
But I haven't had a chance to bring it into you. I will in a minute. I wanted to tell you about my experience at Duncan and ask, do you think that the folks, Duncan is great. I mean, the Manny Sardine and family do a great job, and they give work to lots of folks in our area. But sometimes I'm curmudgeon-y in a way because—
Get off my coffee.
Yeah. They take the hand, okay—
Yes.
And I don't know if they do this at other stores, and I wondered what you thought on this one. I'll ask Rick and Jessica Martin, who will be in here later on today. But they take the hand and they put it on top of the thing like this, and then they go like, you know, they're
Bob.
They're,
unless you saw their hand was all greasy, grimy, it's really not that big of a deal. It's really not.
But we don't want. And then I'm going to take my.
My
lips and put them onto the germ-ridden cup.
Bob, think about the exposure time and how much time it would take to have the exposure problem, right?
Mm.
And the fact that if there were some bacteria on their hands or viruses,
right.
the bacteria would have almost no time to multiply, right?
Oh.
So your exposure's lower. The reason they worry about bacteria and meat and stuff like that is because... If somebody processes the meat, then there's time in between the time the meat's processed and packaged and so the time it gets to your home and whatnot. So it has time for bacteria to grow, you see. That's why.
All right. So these bacteria don't travel in packs. So in other words, they're not glomming on there.
So, yeah. So you'd have to, Bob, their hands would have to be filthy. absolutely filthy for it to make any appreciable difference.
Well, they've been taking my my money and everyone else's money and credit cards and stuff all day.
Okay, Bob, but I also know as most fast food restaurants since COVID have had their employees do an aggressive hand washing thing. Like
oh, really?
All
okay.
the time, yes.
Oh, all right. Okay.
There's more chance of a trace of cocaine off that dollar bill or whatever you gave them, or $5 or $20 bill,
right.
than there is bacteria.
Oh, okay. Alrighty.
Let's be honest.
Yeah, you know, I just want people to be aware.
It's okay to be aware. It's another thing to be paranoid.
You don't hand the guy your cup with the hand on top of the coffee cup. Here comes my personal assistant.
Do you know why that though?
The question.
But you know why you don't do that?
Why?
Because
I can't answer any questions.
The top may pop off. That's why.
The top may pop up.
If you're holding it by the top.
Okay. So Rick. I'll introduce you right here. This is Rick Barry, personal assistant.
No worries.
No,
Rick.
you were handling some important stuff there.
Dealing with some personal business.
Here, yes. I would like to present you with a coffee, and I want you to drink out of it. All right? Take a look at this.
Yeah.
Okay. Here.
Oh, never. Never, never, ever.
Why? Why?
Well, because your hands are dirty.
No, see, the germs. No. You know what?
I
heard Peter say, the top may not be completely secured.
The more thing is you'll be wearing the cup of coffee.
Well,
your hands are one of the two worst places for germs to be. Mm. But I'm not a germaphobe.
Mm.
I am not a germaphobe.
Neither am I.
But
yes, you are, Bob.
It is.
No, I pick things up off the ground and eat them all the time. I don't know that.
Yeah.
I don't know.
That's a whole different ailment.
Yeah, it's true. That's that 3 minutes of 3 second deal.
You just proved my, on the 3 second rule, you just proved my point about it takes time for bacteria to grow.
Yes, but this man or woman who has been waiting on me.
Do you think this person has leprosy or something?
No.
Like that might be one where I said, if I see legions or something, I'd be a little worried.
No.
I see intact hands from these youngsters
that
barely know how to like tie their shoes,
right.
I'm not worried about them because they're freaked out about everything and they're probably washing their hands every 20 minutes.
You're giving people a lot more credit than both Rick and I are, apparently, right?
Yeah.
I see the best.
I used to work in the business, and when you have to remind people to wash their hands, then it's kind of scary.
And then when they go in and wash their hands and then use the dryer in the bathroom that has that, the what's that thing that goes whoosh, whoosh, and you put your hands underneath it?
It's an air dryer,
Bob. It dries with air.
Oh, the air dryer.
Yes.
Yes, but the air that it's drying with is filled with contamination, according to the studies recently. You never dry your hands under one of those things.
Walking outside could kill you.
Of course.
So why worry about little things?
Well, I don't really want to catch a germ. I mean, I'm not
okay,
a jerk. You know,
then wrap yourself up in like the bubble boy thing and have a hermetically sealed environment and you'll never catch anything ever again. Of course, you'll also be the loneliest person on the face of the earth, but you know, that's notwithstanding.
Yeah. Rick, help me here.
You know.
Help me.
You can't be helped on this one, Bob.
Well.
Yeah.
You know, one of the worst things is that, you know, when you see people go in to use the restrooms and they don't wash their hands afterwards.
Yes, right, right.
That's...
It's kind of bad. Or they put their hand on that knob that's been touched by hundreds of people who haven't washed their hands.
Yeah.
What knob?
The knob of the door handle of the bathrooms. Yeah.
You know what, Bob?
Pete, I'm
still here to tell the tale. How's that?
All right,
the odds of
there are reasonable
catching something...
precautions, and then there are unreasonable precautions.
Well, the odds of catching something that'll actually, you know, kill you are low.
Right.
But this still, it's just there are a lot of.
It's kind of like icky. Yeah, I don't know. It's so funny how we. I'm the same way, Peter, that I choose what my toleration level is, and somehow or other in my past, I must have been frightened by a doorknob or something. I have no idea, but I cannot touch a bathroom doorknob. I will do everything.
Yeah, but you have other phobias about public bathrooms, period.
I do. I don't even like to watch them on television. You know that story. I don't like to see a scene in the bathroom at all.
I know you will put yourself in distress and not use the bathroom here.
Yeah. If I use the bathroom here out of sheer, what's the word? Sheer necessity.
Last resort.
The last resort. Yeah, yeah.
You claim you're going home to watch Kelly and whoever, but it's actually to go home and go to the bathroom.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Let's be honest.
Yeah, no. That's
it's true. I was talking to somebody about it after one of your shows, and I was like, Bob gets out of here really fast. And it's like, yeah, because he's got to go home and go to the bathroom. And I'm like, you're serious? I'm like, no. He goes, he doesn't like using public restrooms. I'm like, okay, that's fair. I mean,
people are like that.
Phobias are real.
Yeah, yeah. Ricardo.
Yeah.
A phobia that you'd like to talk about here, and the therapist, crazy therapist that I be, will help you. Is there a phobia? Is there anything? Are you fearful of anything? What makes you frightened?
Besides people?
Yeah, he's in the service industry, everybody. He's in the service industry.
People do scare me.
Oh, yeah.
They really do.
Oh, all right. That's true.
You know?
That's true.
Yeah. I am afraid of heights when I am not on a secure platform or a secure...
Yeah.
For instance, if we were at the edge of the Grand Canyon looking out at the... How close I do you that, get to the edge? How
about I was, that? I was about 5 feet behind. I was afraid that with my size, once I got moving in a direction, inertia, I would go right over the edge.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
No, seriously. I was dead serious.
I can
feel the dread right now thinking about that.
Oh, gosh. It's frightening. How about you?
I could walk right up to the fence as long as there's a fence there.
No,
if there's no fence, I'm a good 5 feet away. I could not go over and look straight down.
I did that when I did that at the Indian Visitor Center, where they have that glass like hooped walkway where you could walk out, and it's like 30 panes of glass or something.
Oh, yes,
clear.
Right. You walk over the cliff.
I can't walk and look down at the same time. I can walk to a spot and look down and then look up and out and then transition to another spot. Christy couldn't do it at all. She was scared witless.
Yeah. You know, one of the big attractions in New York City, I haven't been there, but is... there is a place where you can walk on the outside of a building. I think it's called the Edge or something, and you can actually walk on glass, and you're suspended on the over a building.
Yeah,
and you see the glass underneath or whatever.
Yes,
they have one now that
I'm fearful of that.
They have a ride now that puts you on a beam and you're strapped in.
Yeah,
but you get lifted up on a hydraulic and put like the famous shot of the steelworkers.
Right, right.
You can actually mimic that in New York City.
That's
but
exactly.
But you're strapped in.
Yes.
Yeah.
You have like a strap belt.
We go and do that together?
Well, I went up in Toronto. There is the
Seagram's building.
The tower.
Isn't that the
CN Tower? The CN Tower, yes.
The
CN Tower. Okay. The CN Tower that's outside of Rogers Field.
Yes.
There is a glass elevator that goes up the outside of the building.
Now, see, I'd find that cool.
Glass floor, glass walls, so everything is glass. And then when you get up to the top, you're on the inside. You're inside, and you don't see the ground, but then when you walk out into certain areas, there's a glass floor that looks straight down.
Yeah. Oh, good. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Nope.
No.
No. That high up?
You
nope.
You were able to go up the side of the building. But well, you once you got there, you couldn't.
I was pretty well plastered to the back of the elevator.
Oh, I thought you were plastered. That's
yes,
why. You
well, that too. But I was hugging the back of that elevator and looking straight and looking straight out. I did look down at one point and went, "Yeah, no."
Yeah.
I saw the Towering Inferno one too many times when the elevator let go.
I was just going to say, oh my God, Olivia de Havilland from Gone with the Wind, isn't that the woman inside of it or something?
I believe so, yes.
Yeah, does she get killed?
Yes.
Does the thing plummets to the...
Well, see, now you're not giving a realistic scenario here.
Yeah.
Okay, doctor. What?
Most of these things are over-engineered so that, you know, things don't happen.
Right. But you still look at it, and then you've got people jumping up and down on these glass panels, like the kids and stuff like that.
Oh, no, they're
and
not.
And like, yeah, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm like, nope, no thank you. And then up there at the CN Tower, you can actually go – you can go outside at one point. But then you can also – you can. They also have this thing where you can be harnessed in, and then they, like, have a pulley that like lays you over so you can look down.
So you
so you're basically standing on the edge of the building and then they lean you over.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. So would you kiss the Blarney Stone?
That's a good question. I don't know. I would
have
to see
go
how
out.
It is.
You have to,
yes.
You have to go out and under.
Yeah. You got to, well, first you got to get through that little space, don't you?
Yeah. You have to, but you're out over open air.
I don't think I'm doing it.
I mean, I know there's some bars there, but you're out over open air, basically.
Yeah, the bars would be for me.
I would have a tough time with that.
Have a drink.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I would have a real tough time with that. I just always think that even though it's sort of like that Titanic mentality, that this is the unsinkable ship. You know, this
well,
ship
was,
is unsinkable,
yeah,
and therefore
that
it goes, huh?
That was hubris. That's different. You don't boast about something because it will, the fates of the whatever you believe in will come back to bite you if you boast.
But Peter, just last week, wasn't there a screw that flew off a door or something on a...
That was door seal.
A door seal, or yeah, tell us.
It was actually they were calling it a fuselage plug, but it basically was it replaced a door that they took off that was didn't need to be used. Right? Is that am I correct on that, Peter?
No, it was the overwing door. I thought.
Yeah, it wasn't a door anymore, though. That's what they were they were saying that it wasn't used as a door anymore.
Overwing. I thought that was
it was an unused door on a plane.
Yeah.
Okay. Well.
Well, at any rate, you trust that all the screws that everyone doesn't have that these planes don't have a screw loose like some
a lot of people have a screw loose.
Yeah. But Bob, then there's also the odds, like so of the millions of people that travel every day.
Yeah, it's exactly
one accident out of millions and millions of people, hundreds of thousands of people that have traveled on that actual plane. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yes. True.
So
true.
So like. You have your weighing the odds type thing.
Yeah, that is
like.
That,
do I think I'm going to fall out of the CN Tower? No. Hmm. Would I, knowing if I had that type of phobia, would I put myself into that position? Probably not.
Yeah. What do we call that phobia? Heights. What's is it agoraphobia? No, agoraphobia is
fear
of the marketplace.
Spaces.
Yeah,
fear of
the
marketplace.
Yeah. But what would be the height is
fear
there
of heights.
Fear of heights. What kind of phobia is that?
You know what? I used to know it.
Yeah, me too.
Yes.
Hydrophobia?
No, that's
the
fear
water.
Of water.
Water. Oh man. Arachnophobia. Is that fear of
acrophobia.
Sight.
Acrophobia?
Acrophobia.
Mm-hmm. Like you would never catch me ever, 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 ever.
Yeah.
Even if I was strapped in with harnesses, walking the cables of the Golden Gate Bridge. Like, you know those guys that go paint the bridge all the time and inspect it?
Oh, my God.
Never,
Holy
ever, 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 ever.
Never. Right.
But in an airplane, I'm fine looking out a window and looking down.
Me too. Me too. Yeah. I only got anxious once. I was sleeping and I started to ruminate. I went that below me was air.
Yeah,
it was stupid that I even went there. But I was thinking that I was like Superman. Yeah, I was lying on the seat next to me, so I was sort of, and I was saying, "Geez, this is sort of like flying." And then I pictured myself flying, and then I got frightened of the fact that I was flying. I'm not exactly sure that I could fly. Have you ever done that?
Like you personally flying or flying in a motorized
personally
vehicle?
Flying like Superman. I don't think I could do it. If you know what they have those, when you go up in a kite or you have that thing at the beaches and you go up.
Hang glider. Paragliding.
Yeah. No, thank you. Jumping out of a plane. How about you guys?
And well, here's the thing is, and Pete remembers this at the air show. Remember?
What?
I went up with the Golden Knights.
Yep.
And they sat me at the door.
Yeah.
They sat me at the seat right next to the door.
Were you strapped in?
Yes.
Strapped? We had a seatbelt on.
Okay.
and the door is open. And the door is open to the plane.
Oh.
I could see everything. One point, it was like, oh, my God. Oh, my gosh. Oh, my God. And then all of a sudden it was like, oh, okay, this isn't so bad.
So, yeah.
And when you got up to a certain height, it was like, okay, I can still see the ground, but.
Yeah. what are you playing there in the background there? What do you got?
It's the Golden Knights.
Flying up
yes.
there. Yeah, yeah.
But, yeah, sure. it was a little nerve-wracking at first. And the fact is how.
If you were low
strapped in,
with a
seatbelt from like the 1970s.
Yeah, no.
That's exactly. It wasn't a harness. Yeah, it was just a seatbelt,
lap belt,
and that's it.
No,
yeah,
no. I, and then the mere idea. If you were like, for instance, if you said to me, "Okay, we're gonna," you can jump out of a plane strapped to somebody else who knows what they're doing.
Yeah,
tandem skydiving.
Yeah, a tandem jump. Yeah.
Does that appeal to you?
No, not at all.
No, there's no. I don't think I can do that.
You know,
George Bush, President Bush, did it when he was what 95 years old.
Yeah. I think it was 82 was the first time he did.
Oh, he did. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. But no thank you.
Here's my thing about skydiving. Why would you? First of all, throw yourself out of a perfectly good airplane
because it's the closest thing you'll ever do to actually flying.
And. Hurl yourself towards the earth in the hopes that the parachute will open that somebody else packed.
Yes, I know.
And if they were having a bad day.
Right. Or that string that's connected that you pull was correctly attached.
Yes.
Or that you could even find the string. I'd be screaming and I'm saying, but they're saying, pull the cord, and I'm screaming and I'm going, well, you know, you get sort of like you lose your ability to think
in
the plane, you know, when you get that real anxious feeling.
Right.
How about, okay, but I got the solution, Peter. We got the solution.
What?
Space. We're going to Canaveral, and I'll go into that plane that simulates zero gravity and be able to be like an astronaut.
You want to be a vomit comet rider?
Oh, does vomit?
They call it the vomit comet.
Why? I don't know.
Because you're doing parabolic arcs. That's how you achieve weightlessness.
Oh, yeah, but what's the thing about the vomit? I'm not going to, it's like.
Several people who are not used to that feeling of weightlessness sensation vomit.
And then the vomit just travels.
Yeah, until they get into a downward spiral in the arc, and then it all drops to the floor.
So are you saying that you sign a release that says, I don't mind being in the air as long as, even if there's vomit?
Well, you should know what you're getting into.
Okay. All right. Suppose there wasn't any vomit. I could do that. I could do the weight.
I went on a ride at Epcot, which is called Journey to Mars, I think.
Mm. Yeah.
That there are two different flavors of it. There's a low G version. There's a high G version.
Uh huh. Right.
I did the high G version.
Yeah. I did the extreme also.
Oh, you did. Yeah.
Yeah.
And what? And good.
It was a blast.
And were you flying?
I don't know, Peter. I didn't feel weightlessness, but the G's though.
The G loading on the liftoff was what did they say, like 9G.
Incredible. That was the way you feel. Just it. You feel like you're going forward, but you're being forced backwards. Is that a proper way to describe it?
Yeah.
You feel like you're going forward.
Your eyes tell you're moving forward.
You're moving forward, but your body is being forced backwards.
I just got it. I just got that feeling.
As you just look, you're
yeah.
You're in they tell you
that's a weightlessness feeling.
They tell you that at one point you have to press a button and you're trying to get to touch the button and you can't.
I love it. Hey everybody, what's no snow in the forecast at all?
Tuesday.
Yeah.
Oh, today.
Tonight. 1 to 3.
On Tuesday.
Yeah.
1 to 3 tonight.
Yep.
So you want to build a snowman?
Yeah. No.
Peter, that was a cue.
After last week, we probably could have, but then with all the rain, everything's gone now. Mostly gone. There's still a little bit of snow.
Look, out here, there are in our parking lot.
The snow banks are still there.
Snow banks will be here probably till April, right? I don't know. Snow banks, it takes a while.
Yeah, depending if we get a warm spot.
Yeah. So when was the last snowman you built?
A couple of years ago.
You did actually build a snowman in your yard?
Yep.
Did you start with a little snowball and you rolled it and you rolled it and you rolled it? I haven't done that since I was a child.
Oh, yeah.
Oh. Hmm. How big a snowball are you are we capable of rolling?
It depends on you've got to get the second and third tier up there, so you've got to figure out how to do that.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. But could you conceivably get a 6 or 7 foot snowball?
You could.
How?
Yeah, but
do you think do people do that?
Yeah.
Is there a truck that could do that? I mean, you could do it with your truck, couldn't you?
Actually, you know what the easiest way to do it, and this is probably cheating, is you take your snowblower, you take your shovel and shovel it all into a big pile, and then you sculpt it into a ball.
Oh, that's you're cheating. All right, Peter, you ready to play Do You Want to Build a Snowman from Frozen?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, these are all stars of Disney, young stars of Disney. We'll ask Jessica Martin when we return whether she wants to build a snowman with us.
Do you want to build a snowman? Come on, let's go and play. I never see you anymore. Come out the door, it's like you've gone away. We used to be best buddies, and now we're not. I wish you would tell me why. Do you want to build a snowman? It doesn't have to be a snowman. Okay, bye. Build a snowman.
Do you
want
to build a snowman?
Doesn't have to be a snowman.
Don't have to be a snowman.
Okay. Bye.
Elsa, please, I know you're in there. I've been waiting for you. Where you've been.
You're right.
We're here for you.
Just for me.
We only have each other.
We only have each other.
What are we gonna do?
build a snowman.
Do you wanna build a snowman?
It doesn't have to be a snowman. Okay, bye.
Support for Community Radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield.
I'm Mark Auerbach. Join me every Friday at 8 a.m. for Arts Beat, where you'll meet interesting actors, directors, designers, and musicians here in Western New England.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Wow, we're having a laugh. We're having a drink here.
No, hey, Bob, do you know that
we're dreaming of having a drink here?
Yeah. One of our other shows has an endorsement from Superman.
What are you kidding me?
Listen.
Hey, this is Dean Cain. You're listening to my friends Robbie, Lynn, and Pete on the Bobby G and Company Show on WSKB 89.5 FM. I'm also listening right alongside
Dean Cain, that Dean Cain?
Yeah, that Superman. Dean Cain.
He has such a young voice.
He does have a young voice.
He has
voice.
A young face.
He's a young
He's
face.
He's notoriously young.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Hey, everyone, that was the voice of Jessica Martin.
Good morning.
Yeah, and this is the voice of Peter Coles.
Hello.
This is the voice of Rick Barry, personal assistant.
Good morning.
This is my voice. Hi.
This is my
I'm Bob Plast.
Here's Bob's voice.
For my Bob.
Okay. Hey, everyone, we ask you to go to westfieldonweekends.com. You can see all the information. You can donate. You can participate, or et cetera, et cetera. We are the I'm still humbled by our vote as the not-for-profit of the year. There are plenty of profits, non-for-profits that are out there doing great work, and we salute all of them. All right. Hey,
Hi.
Jessica.
Good morning.
We were just, you just told me about, we were talking.
A shocking revelation.
A shocking. my weight loss, okay, which
yeah,
I attribute.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is, it's continuing to, I got about another 5 more pounds.
Maybe. Okay.
Okay, and then I've got to handle the waddle.
Under the knife?
No,
the
I'm not.
Surgery?
No, I'm never going under. I can hardly, no. I can't get in an airplane. No, I can't go into a bathroom. How am I going to go under the knife?
Yeah, that's okay.
Yeah, public bathrooms, you know, we talked about. Okay, so we were talking about, We're talking about drinking or not drinking.
Yes.
Okay. And you're saying that there is a study out there that you just read as a realtor.
It came into
Jessica Martin Realty, incidentally.
Specifically in the real estate news. It came into from a newsletter that I receive that's for, you know, business based industry industry website. They put out a result that said women real estate agents are wildly obsessed with drinking. We drink a lot because
probably
of the
wine.
Stress. Yeah.
Really? Do you think it's because they're taking their customers out to lunch and hoping for you serve a,
yes,
a drink?
Yes, that's,
them.
That's one
no,
part
you're
of
kidding.
It. So they said culturally in our country that women overall are drinking a lot more. The number in the article was 84% more than 10 years ago. Like women were consuming that much more alcohol, that the increase was that great over 10 years. And they're saying that it's societal pressure to start to being a woman in our society, being a wife, being a mother, and still being expected to have a career. And now also perform on social media. So you have to do all of these things and you have to look good publicly while doing it.
Yeah.
So that becomes very stressful. And it's a lot of getting home at the end of the day and cracking a bottle of wine. And instead of having a glass, having a bottle. So consumption's increased. And then the article went on to say that because real estate is in like the top five of the most stressful jobs, that increases that drinking even more. So apparently we're a bunch of booze hounds. And yes, a lot of our events are alcohol based. You always have a happy hour or you take people out for drinks to celebrate. There's all kinds of let's go to a boozy mimosa brunch at an open house. Like there's always cocktails. And it is difficult to say.
So you're serving cocktails when you see an open house? You go to I could actually, if I were wanting to, I could go from house to house and have a couple of free drinks like at Costco or something with
technically not for the consumer. I know there are people I've done it myself where you offer a cocktail or a glass of wine at a fancier version of an open house. I don't think we're actually supposed to be serving alcohol to the public, but there are a lot of broker functions where if you have a broker's open house, we call it. So it's going to be other real estate professionals coming in to tour the home and give their feedback. They often will serve lunch or drinks or something along those lines to, get people to come on in and have a reason to stop by. So, if you need your mid-morning cocktail.
So, Jessica, are you part of the National Association of Realtors?
Oh, unfortunately, Peter, yes. Why are you asking?
Do you know who the new president is?
I don't know. I know that there was just another controversy, like a third person just stepped down. There's been a lot of problem with leadership there this year.
I went to school with him.
Oh, excellent.
He's from this area?
He went to Cathedral.
Excellent. Oh, no. So we're finally going to have somebody good over there?
Kevin Sears.
Excellent.
Wait a minute. Kevin Sears.
Sears Realty.
Please do a good job, Kevin.
Sears, where? No, spell Sears. C-Y-R-S?
No, S-E-A-R-S. Like Sears.
Sears.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. School, do you know him?
I don't know him, no, but I will be interested to dig
into
that.
My brother went to school with his brother. I went to school with Kevin. Yeah.
So how does somebody get to be the president of an American association
They kick out the three previous people in leadership.
Had some kind of smear campaign against her
advertised it as a blackmail campaign. Yeah. Someone tried to blackmail her to do something in her position that she found to be untoward, and they tried to blackmail her. So she said, someone's trying to blackmail me, so I'm stepping down.
Really?
Yeah.
And, was that
and
big
before
news
that, thing? It was a sexual harassment scandal. It's big news in my business. I'm sure Peter knows about it from reading the headlines and knowing somebody local.
I just found out about my brother. I was my brother told me, because Kevin Sears is like the president of the realtors?
They've been in a lot
national
of
president?
So what does it mean? I mean, as consumers, do Rick and I have to look for somebody who's sanctioned by the American Realtors Association?
You do not have to. And the organization we're talking about is called the National Association of Realtors, NAR, N-A-R. And the big thing that they offer is a code of ethics. So in order to belong to NAR, you have to subscribe to their specific code of ethics, and you have to take a class and pay for the privilege, of course, to have the distinction.
Yeah.
It's a trade association.
Yes. So they do recommend that you become a member. And a lot of local boards and local associations, which you have to be a part of in order to participate in real estate, require your membership in the National Association.
So give me some of those other things that you have to participate in order to be a realtor in the area.
It's really, so you need a local board to be a member of. So
a local board of?
Real estate. Realtors. Yeah, a local board of realtors. So in my case, it's the Greater Hartford Association of Realtors my first board. Right. And then here we have Pioneer Valley. So you pick your local board, and then you have to also be a member of a state board for the state that you're in. So I have the Connecticut Association and the Massachusetts Association of Realtors, and then they are under the umbrella of the National Association. So everyone charges a fee, and you hand over your money, and you have the right to practice real estate in your area.
My God.
Yeah, it's a lot.
So what if you wanted to sell us a house in Arizona?
I would have to refer you to an Arizona agent, and I could kind of handhold in that transaction. I could introduce you, which is funny you picked Arizona because I do know some agents
you're
in Arizona.
You're selling in Arizona,
yeah. Yeah. But and if a license is reciprocal as a broker, I can just get a license in such and such a state. I'm thinking about doing it with Florida because we go there often enough. If I were to get my Florida license, you and I could fly down to Florida together if you and James were looking to get a winter place.
Do you really think that I want to move to Florida?
I mean, I don't.
Do
I
you really?
You were
a bad really example. Think yeah. that I want to move to Florida.
If you did, I could go with you. That's all.
All right. If you went with us,
yes.
I got to bring my assistant with me. I got
to
bring. I'd have to bring.
You have to bring. I'd have to bring
my Republican friend Peter.
Yes, and with Peter, because he can navigate Florida for us as yeah, a Republican. Yes,
that's
oh,
very
for Christ's
true.
Sake.
Yeah. No, really, we need you there.
Yes,
I need help. I need help.
If I was going to leave right now, I'd probably move to Texas.
Texas is nice.
Because of the space. Because only because of the space industry.
Yeah,
I might, you know,
Houston is a growing market.
Well, I know. I think I would go to Austin. I think I'm more suited for Austin,
Texas. Arts and music and a lot of culture in Austin.
The socialist capital of Texas.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hey, I was speaking of that drinking thing. Wait a minute. No,
back to alcohol, though, please.
No, I was with Probe and Mina this week. Because Probe and Mina, who own Mina's Wine and Spirits in Westfield, they've been here for years. They are from, they are originally from India.
Yes.
And they came here from India. So we're doing a photographic exhibit that we are taking the portraits with this wonderful photographer. I think I've told you while I was doing this. We got a grant from the Cultural Council for taking portraits of immigrants to Westfield. And so we took Mina and Probe. And in the course of... And they were dressed to the nines.
They're fabulous.
Sari and his outfit was great. But in the course of it, we were talking, and they were saying, and this is very interesting, that Probe and Mina own a package store for guys out in Wisconsin.
Yeah.
That's a liquor store.
A liquor store.
Do they call them package stores in Connecticut?
Yes.
New England is a packy.
New England, we say the packy.
Yeah. Yep. You got to make a packy run.
Packy run.
Is that because that we all have to, you can't carry liquor on the street, you have to put it into a packy?
The old blue laws, that's what it was. Yes. It was because they had to go into a package.
Oh. Is that right?
Right. Now it doesn't matter anymore. You can
just carry it out.
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah. Okay.
You can't have an open container, but you can.
You can't
carry
can't,
your.
You can't have an open container.
Bob, you can carry your Natty Light with pride.
Yes. Right out the
door. Here's to athletic beer. Yeah. Yeah. So you put the paper bag over the bottle,
and you call it a package.
Yeah. And you could drink. Can I drink out of that paper?
No.
Technically, you're not supposed to, but
in New York City, we can.
Oh yeah. In Bermuda, you can too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You just put it in a little package.
There's also states in the country where you can't. Oh, I see. You just said New York, but I remember
Louisiana,
New Orleans. One of my favorite things about New Orleans was you could just drink everywhere.
You could just take your drink
talk to the police in the street while you're covered alcohol. Yeah.
The police could have a drink while they're we're all having. Okay.
Somebody has to have standards, Bob.
So, yeah.
Yeah. So listen to this. So Probe told me that he said, you know, I'm really concerned because in his business right now, he has seen a drastic reduction.
Well, it's January. In the number of sales. Dry January. Everybody knows
it's
that.
Dry January.
Oh, it's dry January. But
as a liquor store owner, I would imagine dry January and sober October are the worst months of the year because everyone just tries to give their liver a break, right?
I didn't even know sober October.
That's the Joe Rogan one.
Yeah, why would anybody do sober October?
I know, it's a terrible time not to drink.
Oktoberfest, man, hello.
Yeah.
Yeah, really. Sober October.
I think just because it kind of rhymes, they picked it, but it is a bad time of year.
Yeah.
That's kind of when you start ramping up for all that whole holiday season, which is why you need dry January.
Well, do you know that according to him, throughout the year, even in December and November,
it's been dropping.
Dropping, and you know why?
Tell me.
He said that the young men and women,
it's weed.
Yes.
Ah.
Cannabis.
Yep. That makes sense.
Sounds about right.
Yeah. Is changing also, the course of the package store industry.
Which is why the package store industry needs to start carrying the cocktails that have the weed in them, the cannabis. That's the thing.
No, wait a minute. Yes. What is that? Tell me about that.
You haven't had this?
No.
I'm shocked. This is going to change your life now that you're not drinking alcohol.
All right, so tell me.
They make seltzers, just like hard alcohol seltzers. They make seltzers that have cannabis in them, and you can drink one and then be high.
No.
Yes. It's fabulous.
Oh.
I mean, I've heard it's fabulous.
So, Bob,
I think Bob's more of an edibles guy.
Yeah, but it works faster than
the
edibles.
Well, you know, Peter, though, no, because I'm drinking Virgin Marys now.
Yeah.
Because I when they bring the
so you're drinking
tomato
juice.
Well, you know, with a little spice. Yeah.
You know what?
The only way I can get the tomato juice down is if there's vodka in it. Come on.
Okay. So, but I thought, you know, when I drink like coffee and something, I could, or if it were soda, I would be just guzzling it.
Yeah.
Okay. The thickness of the tomato juice.
Yeah.
Gross. And if it's V8, all the more power to it. If it's Clamato, all the more power.
You're not worried about the sodium in that?
Oh no. Oh, wait a minute.
Everything will kill you.
You got to watch out for the sodium.
That's how we started the show.
Everything will kill you.
Oh, here we go. Okay. So at any rate, so my thought was when the cocktails are served, I've got a stick of celery. I've got olives.
Like a salad in your drink.
I've got
yeah.
the salad. And when you drink the thick tomato juice, it feels you don't want to just glog it down.
Yeah.
So you sip it.
Yeah.
But you're saying that, like, I could drink something like beer?
No, it's like a seltzer. I haven't seen a beer product yet, but it's like a seltzer. You've seen the seltzers are all the rage now. Truly's and White Claws and all those malt liquor beverages low carb, no sugar, all that stuff.
Right.
They make a seltzer product that has cannabis in it. They're mostly 5 milligrams, which is like low.
Right.
But you can control how much you're putting in. So you can have a half of one or you can sip it all through the evening and just feel a little bit high. Or you can chug it and be pretty high. Or you can drink 4 of them. I don't know. But... It's not alcohol, so, you know.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
So, Rick, I think this, are they going to serve this at the bar? Do you think?
I don't know.
I don't know how they're going to do it.
I'm not sure if the alcohol ones are legal in Massachusetts yet.
The alcohol seltzers?
Yeah.
Oh,
the
really?
Hard one.
The cannabis infused ones are...
I know you can get them in places. I haven't seen any of the, like the beers that people have come up with the alcohol beer and, you know, with cannabis in them. Yeah.
Well, because that's going to be the most difficult hurdle, right? Because even when you go to a dispensary to purchase cannabis products,
right.
you're not allowed to open it or consume it or do anything with it because technically, federally, this is all still illegal.
Right.
So you can purchase it and take it home to your house and, you know, in secret, do whatever you're going to do to consume it.
Oh.
But there's no rules yet for public consumption of cannabis. And that's where this, like we were just talking about, the liquor store thing is going to change. Because when there does become a space where you can go and order a cannabis cocktail or smoke a joint or do all the cannabis consumption in public, that's going to change our society with the social things that have all changed since we've had COVID and everyone just being on Zoom and being social anymore. So if you could go to a bar that was a cannabis bar, that would be a whole different thing.
Well,
I don't know how they're going to regulate hookah bars. I don't know much about that. Just that you can smoke inside.
I think
inside.
That's possible here in Massachusetts. Am I totally
yeah.
wrong?
Oh, yeah. There are hookah
like
bars.
Like cigar lounges.
So isn't that similar? Yeah. Couldn't a hookah bar, instead of a hookah, serve me a drink?
Except tobacco is not illegal, right? So they're all tobacco-based, which is legal. So
are hookah bars tobacco-based?
Yes.
Or there's no cannabis at the hookah?
No. I mean, there's not supposed to.
Oh, geez.
Yeah. It's still illegal to consume cannabis in any space.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh,
It has to be done in the privacy of your own.
Yes.
Well,
you can't do it on the sidewalk. Okay. You can't do it in public.
So there's a first step toward this changing because this week, didn't they come out and change the? It's no longer a substance 3. It's no longer
classification.
Yeah. That's a federal thing, though.
Yeah, that's federal.
That's a federal. So now they've reduced it to the same thing as Tylenol.
Yeah, but it's still illegal.
It's still illegal.
Federally, yes.
Okay. All right.
They may have done it on a state level, but the only one that really counts is the federal classification.
Okay. So, look, listen to this. This is George Lenker. Do you read him in the newspaper at all?
I can't.
George Lenker has a column in the weekend section of the Springfield Republican, the Republican, and he says, Happy New Year. I want to offer some thoughts and predictions for 2024. Will be a year of slight growth, but guided by cautious hands. If I ruled the craft beer world, I'd love to see more small to medium breweries narrow their focus a bit. It's great to have a portfolio, but that doesn't mean you have to have a dozen different styles or even a dozen different beers. There's nothing wrong with featuring an IPA, a stout, a pale ale, a sour, and maybe one or two other styles. Lagers, of course, are always refreshing. On the other hand, there are cases where I'd love to see a bit more diversity. One trend that I'd like to slow down is the New England IPA craze. But again, if tons of people are still buying them at heady clip, then so be it. My final wish is for more cask beer to be available. I understand the risks of selling.
I would agree with that.
And maybe that leads me to the resolution part. If you're a craft beer fan, I assume you love real ale, so make sure you resolve to support any event that features craft ale.
Okay. I'm interested to hear Rick's feedback on this subject.
Your comment on that?
I guess so. That would be...
He's our expert.
On cask beer, I would love to see more of our local establishments doing. Skyline in Westfield does them.
Can you tell me what that is?
A cask beer is a smaller... They'll take the beer and they'll put it into a smaller vessel.
Yeah.
It looks like a small keg.
Okay.
And it is naturally carbonated.
Oh.
And they will either age it on oak chips, they'll age it on some more hops or whatever.
Right.
But it's naturally aspirated. So what they'll do is they'll take and they actually will tap the cask with a spigot.
Oh, okay.
So you take it, and in fact, there is a video of me on doing it a couple of weeks ago up at Skyline.
Really?
I was tapping the cask.
Tapping a cask.
Yeah.
Sometimes they'll buy old barrels of like whiskey and stuff like that, right?
Well, that's aging. But a cask is different. Okay. It's a smaller vessel where they will, instead of force carbonating a beer with CO2, they will actually add some fermentation sugars into the cask to allow it to start the fermentation, it'll start carbonating it itself.
Well, why is there a rule against that?
No. It's naturally aspirated beer or naturally carbonated beer will taste a lot better. You get more of the natural flavors out of it instead of that, bubbly, tingly thing. That's
super fizzy.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
Is it cost prohibitive because they're making?
It is a little bit more expensive. They do it in smaller increments.
Runs. Yep.
And what I would like to see is more places doing their casks or doing a full cask with a what's known as a beer engine.
A beer engine.
Okay.
So basically, what it is, it sits in the barn. I'm trying to see the last place that I saw one around here was. It sits on the bar, and you'll watch them. They will pump it. Smith Billiards over in Springfield has one. They will actually pump it, so they're actually drawing the beer up.
And then CO2 into it?
No, actually, it's being aspirated by oxygen. As it's going into the glass and coming out, it is being carbonated at that point. Very low carbonation.
Yeah.
And what you'll see them is they'll pull it. And it usually has a hook-shaped nozzle on it, which helps the aspiration of it to get the slightest carbonation in there.
Wow.
And it's somewhat of a work to do, but it gives a great flavor to the beer.
Better flavors.
Better flavors of the beer, yes. It pulls a lot of them right out.
Wow.
I like it.
Wow. Are you a beer drinker, Jessica Martin?
I will say that I've gotten off beer as I get older because, just like everyone, your tummy changes and you can't tolerate the things you tolerated in your youth. So if I drink beer, I tend to get a little bit of an upset tummy. I do like it a lot.
Yeah.
So if there's an occasion, like what Rick's talking about, if I went somewhere and he's like, you have to try this beer, like I would drink that beer, but I'm not trying to go out and have a pitcher of beer with my pizza anymore because I know it'll hurt my stomach.
So
special beers only.
So, yeah. We're talking about how culture is changing given the things that are happening in culture.
Mm-hmm.
And that now that cannabis is becoming more legal, it's changing things.
Yeah.
Now that people are drinking less.
Yep.
Now today is mocktail. Am I right?
Mocktail
Isn't
Day?
Isn't that
we
National
have a Mocktail,
mocktail Day,
day
or something? I think it's National Mocktail Day.
National Mocktail Day.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. It's National Mocktail. Oh, no, it's National
Mocktail
Week.
Mocktails get a whole week.
You get a whole week.
Yeah.
Well, it's good to have in January since everyone's trying to be dry January.
Yeah. Right? Are you doing dry January?
No, I'm doing just like everyone. You try to, you know, better yourself in the new year based on the article we just talked about and the real estate and the alcohol and my self-reflection going, I could definitely drink a little bit less. I'm going to try to drink a little bit less. I'm not going to try to, like, special occasions, you know, not.
But I wonder, given the world as it is, I mean, we're both here. We are. We're talking about Bob. You're not drinking any longer, so have you considered maybe drinking cannabis? Cannabis, okay.
Because you still like to party.
and that urge to party.
Do
you think that's a human? I mean, we always want to get beyond the feeling that we have into something more euphoric.
100% Everyone is looking for some sort of a coping mechanism. Like, you need something to... It's to cope, really. Like, so in, and we use things like that in all the different times. Food has become similar too. Like, you eat and drink to celebrate. You eat and drink when you're sad. You eat and drink when people come together. Like, think about a gathering and then saying, okay, we're all going to gather, but we're not going to have food or drinks. Like, bring your own coffee or water, and then we're going to play music and still, you know, all talk to each other. But now what you have is like an Alcoholics Anonymous meeting. You don't have a party, right?
No,
like,
it's
crazy, but it's true, right? You need a little bit of lubrication.
It just brought back a memory. In New York City once, I was invited to this party. So I brought the six-pack to the, and I brought it in, and the gentleman told me that this is a party.
It's a dry party.
It's a dry party because we're all in AA.
Oh, gosh.
And I don't know
why did you invite me? No.
I thought to myself, well, you could have at least
told me. Yeah.
You know, and I had a good time.
Yep.
But immediately my expectations about my good time
were lowered totally. Bit. Yeah.
Does that happen to you? I mean, like.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's difficult for me, even just considering like drinking less, like thinking about like I play cards on Thursday nights.
You play cards.
In a bar. So.
Oh, even.
Yeah, so it's like, how do you go into the bar and not just order a drink and then go sit down at your table to play cards? So it's a team sport. I have a partner, and we realized the first season that we played together that it's best for us not to drink in our first two rounds of cards.
Correct.
So that we play better.
Oh, my God.
So you don't get snookered.
Yeah, so we do. Yeah,
that's why
that's a whole different sport.
No, you get snookered in snookers, too.
So that was the key. So that's how we did that. We're like, okay, we're not going to drink when we get here. We're going to wait until we play our first two rounds. And then in the third round, if we feel like it, we're allowed to order a cocktail at that point. So it's like things like that, like setting limits and boundaries. But it is difficult to say, okay, well, I'm going out with this person, and this is a person I normally, you know, throw back some drinks and have a wild time with.
Rick, I ask you that when you go out on a night and you say, well, we're going out, we're going to have a nice night, but we're not drinking tonight. Mm-hmm. Are your expectations lowered?
Of what? How the night's going to be?
Yeah.
No.
Not at all.
Necessarily, no.
I'm just thinking of all those college kids or younger dating world where without the bar. Mm-hmm. Well, actually, what Probe said to me, what these college kids are staying in their rooms and smoking dope.
Weird. Yeah.
Rather than going out to the bars, that the bars are actually changing
as well. People seem to be more isolated than ever.
I just wonder then the dating scene is changed. Mm-hmm. And if we're all drinking mocktails.
Yeah.
Then I've got to.
Are you afraid no one's ever going to hook up?
Yeah, I was thinking of that. Yeah. I mean, that was part of the deal.
Right?
In my mind, I wanted to be loose enough to be able to be.
Sure.
What in my mind was a much more fun person.
Yes, of course.
Whereas.
You gotta let go of some of your inhibitions, right? And sometimes we need help with that.
It's so, so true. Hey, everybody, I've got to play a song from because I want to boost her career totally. Leve, do you know Leve?
Not yet.
Her name is spelled L-A-U-F-E-Y.
I'm trying to find it in the notes here.
Laufey.
Okay.
It looks like Laufey.
Laufey.
Okay. Laufey. She is from Iceland. I've been playing some of her songs. This is a great song for the start of the year because it's called From the Start. And it's bossa nova. What young person in America today who's writing music is writing bossa nova type songs? That
you're
are
from South America, you might be writing.
Yeah, well, true. And she's from Iceland on top of everything else. She now lives in California. But I wonder about this because, again, it's an example of the music world changing that we have a young 20-year-old person, I think she's 26 or 27, writing music for young that sounds as if Antonio Carlos Jobim wrote it. Mm-hmm. So get this. This is Laufey, L-A-U-F-E-Y. We talked about it. I think I did a reel on it, an Instagram reel. Hey, follow me on Instagram at PlasBob, incidentally. And you'll hear all about the people like Laufey. This is Laufey. I think they pronounce it La. I think we got to. She's got to change her name to Alice.
That'd be easier.
Or something, wouldn't it? I mean, like when you have a name that you can't pronounce, it's like that.
That's part of the charm, Bob.
Yeah,
you think so? How do you pronounce the guy that's the, he's a mime, a mime artist, not a mime. He. What do you call it when you mimic somebody's voice?
Oh, not the ventriloquist. You are a...
What are you when you mimic somebody's voice?
Impressionist.
Impressionist. An impressionist.
Impersonator.
There's a
impersonator.
Guy named...
Impersonator.
Oh, yeah. You gotta Google and listen to this guy. He's so great. He was at the Golden Globes. Tom Wom Gans.
Impersonator. We impersonate radio hosts.
That's
you know.
True. We're doing it right now.
Yeah. Check out Tom Wom Bangs.
Tom Wom Bangs.
B-A-G-N. Again, another case where it's impossible to pronounce Tom's last name. Laufey and Tom Wom Bangs, I want to introduce you all to.
Don't you notice how I get quiet when there's no one else around? Me and you and awkward silence. Don't you dare look at me that way. I don't need reminders of how you don't feel the same. Oh, the burning pain. Listening to you heart bump out some new soulmate. She's so perfect, blah, blah, blah. Oh, how I wish you'll wake up one day. Run to me, confess your love. At least just let me say that when I talk to you, oh, Cupid. What's a girl to do? Lying on my bed, staring into the blue. Unrequited, terrifying. Love is driving me a bit insane. Have to get this off my chest. I'm telling you today that when I talk to you, oh, Cupid walks right through and shoots a arrow through my heart. And I sound like a loon, but don't you feel it to confess I loved you from the start. Confess I loved you, just thinking of you. I know I've loved you.
Underwriting for Community Radio on WSKB is brought to you in part by Rockies. Over 30 convenient locations throughout Massachusetts, Rhode Island, New Hampshire, Connecticut, and Florida. One of the nation's largest Ace dealers. Expertise and great product selection in paint, hardware, lawn and garden. That's Rockies, rock solid service since 1926. On the web at Rockies.com.
This is Ken Stomsky from Ken's Den on WCPC 15 and 89.5 FM, Tuesdays 8 to 10.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM, WSKB Westfield.
Well, it is Tuesday. It is January. Give me the date. It's 16, right?
That's correct.
Yeah, January 2023. Yes, and 15. Counting.
Yes, 16. Yes.
16, almost halfway through the month. And Jessica, if you want to take the plunge.
Oh, the plunge.
The plunge.
No.
Yes.
Coming
Come
up
take
soon.
The plunge.
I'll happily donate to Rick's campaign to plunge, but cold water and I are not friends.
All right.
It's supposed to be super healthy for you, too. That's like
it's cold water immersion, yes, is very healthy.
It is supposed to be healthy?
Yes.
Sean Martin takes cold showers on purpose for his
Your husband takes cold showers?
He's out of his mind, yes. Yeah. Oh, that's actually, now I hear what I just
now
said.
Now you heard what
I
you just said.
Poor guy. Oh, what a poor guy. I mean, what are you doing to him? Get in that shower. Get in that shower.
First of all, not due to any grief. Not due to any grief I've caused.
Yeah.
How long do you remain in a cold shower?
So this morning he was in 3 minutes. Ice cold water.
Rick?
Yeah. What's it? It's cold showers. Yeah.
No, thank you.
During the summer, sometimes I will, but.
Yeah, I guess it gets hot outside, but in the winter.
No. But in the winter, you're going to plunge. He's plunging into the cold water of Hampton Ponds.
I can't even imagine.
Yes.
On January 29th.
27th.
Oh, 27th.
27th. Saturday the 27th.
Right. And
we hit the water.
Good luck.
You do. And in order to if anyone wanted to find out about the Penguin Plunge, they go to where?
They could go to the Amelia Park Children's Museum website.
Right.
And just, it is AmeliaParkMuseum.org.
Yeah.
And under the events section is all the information.
Penguin Plunge.
Yeah, it says Penguin Plunge 2024.
This supports.
And you can sign up there.
Links to donate there.
And the links can, you can link to donate right there. You can find people on there. Or you can check out my Facebook page. I post it two or three times a day. The link to go to site.
I got to do it. Maybe I'll do it during a commercial here or something.
And you will also see, you know, cute pictures of penguins and on there too. As I post that.
Why are penguins considered so cute?
They are very cute.
What is
they
it?
Are.
Is it because they are the waddle of a penguin? Probably. The waddle from the side waddle. To side.
I think penguins one of those animals that mate for life too. I could be wrong.
I think you have to be a particular kind of penguin.
A particular penguin.
Yes.
And I think it's the king or queen penguin.
The emperor penguin and the emperor king penguin. Penguin. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. They mate for life.
There's all sorts of things.
Yeah. 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 There are other penguins that are out there having drinks and getting up.
Yes.
Polyamorous penguins.
Yeah, yeah, really, really. Yeah. Playing cards in bars on Thursday nights.
That's a thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
So, as a penguin who plays on Thursday, what card game are you playing on Thursday night?
I play Setback. Thank you for asking. It's my favorite.
Setback.
Some call it Pitch.
Setback.
Pitch.
I love Pitch. Okay.
High-low jack game.
Four times.
Yes. Yep.
High-low jack game. And so, where does one find people? You're playing
a
in tournaments?
League?
Yeah, so it's a league. So we play at the Knights of Columbus. Yeah, and it's a league, and you sign up and you pay a little entry fee, and you play for 10 weeks on Thursday nights. And then if you are seated in the top of the brackets, you play in the playoffs, and you have a chance to win money. And then there's a nice little banquet at the end. You get some really good food, and it's super fun to just, again, socialize with people who like to play cards. You get strategy, so you're keeping your mind sharp. If you want to have drinks, there's that available as well.
Unbelievable. Holy.
Yeah, it's super fun. I've met a bunch of fun people, and we're amongst some of the younger, but now there are actually a lot of teams younger than we are in our 40s. Yeah, because there's a lot. It's the Knights of Columbus, so there's a lot of older men.
Of course. Oh, my God. Yeah. Oh, God. I'm a Knight of Columbus.
Are you?
Yeah.
You're a Knight of Columbus? Do you know they still do not allow women?
They don't allow women?
Yeah, you cannot be a member as a woman of the Knights of Columbus. You're welcome to.
There's a Knights Auxiliary. Facilities,
but you can't be.
You have an auxiliary. A woman.
I think there's a Knights Auxiliary. Okay. I think
auxiliary membership. Yeah.
It's still kind of like crazy. I remember. My father made me join because he was a Knight.
He was a Knight of Columbus.
And I actually have some insurance from 40,000 years ago.
Yeah, that's perfect. Yeah, because they do offer things like that, and they do good stuff for the community. Yeah. And there's all kinds of things. Yeah. But
I don't even think we have. Do we have a Knights of Columbus in Westfield, Massachusetts?
I don't think we have like the place over in Chicopee, but I think there is a.
There's two Knights Councils in Chicopee, actually.
Two.
There's the Castle of Knights, and there's one on Granby Road.
Maybe
we
that's
used
where
to
it
go.
Is.
My father used to take us. The reason why he liked being a Knight of Columbus is because they had spaghetti dinners once a month.
Tons of stuff
they
like
still
that.
Do.
Yes,
they do a lot of community service.
And
stuff.
The catering at the particular one we go to the one in Enfield, and they have really good food, and it's very well priced, and you get good meals.
You know, I think that the Knights of Columbus Hall in Enfield is where I used to go to play bingo on Saturday
probably
nights.
Probably true. They have a huge hall upstairs. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, gosh.
We had our wedding reception there.
No.
Yes. They have an outdoor pavilion and a big field, and we had a barbecue catered wedding reception. So it was super fun.
With or without booze?
Oh, definitely with booze, yeah.
With an open bar or without an open bar?
Oh, it was a full open bar, yes.
Full open bar. Yeah,
Wild time.
Uh-huh. Did you invite your clients to your wedding?
I didn't have clients when I had a wedding. I was pre-real estate. I've been married almost 15 years, and I've only been doing real estate for 9 years. So,
9 years.
Yeah.
Whatever forced you into real estate?
Just burnout from other things, right? That's when you change your career. When you're tired of what you're doing, you look for something else. So that's where I was.
And the beauty of real estate, if you could say to somebody out there, become a real estate owner, you too can drink like the rest of us.
If you like to drink, you could do real estate.
Yeah. But what would be the purpose in becoming a real estate broker? Or salesman.
So I like the customer service part, the helping people part. Like that's the part of the work that I like doing.
Yeah.
But also that you are sort of an independent contractor type person. You're technically self-employed.
Right.
So you do get to make your own hours, and you can work as little or as much as you want and then be compensated accordingly. So it's kind of a choose your own adventure job.
Yeah.
So that's what I like about it.
Do you think is the industry right now saying, we don't need any more salespeople?
I'm certainly saying that, yes. So I hope the rest of the industry is. Yeah, there's just a lot of, during all the COVID time when you could do everything on Zoom, there are a lot of people who chose to, come out of whatever business they were in, or if you were laid off from your job, it was a great time to take a real estate course online and then, maybe start trying to sell real estate. And it did kind of muddy the waters for anyone that had any type of experience, because you're working with a lot of inexperienced people in the field now.
Yeah.
Which is a little bit crazy. So I do think right now we're probably oversaturated. Also because the market's been so crazy and everyone's been making so much money over the last few years, it made other people say, oh, well, I'm going to do that too. If, everyone's getting some, I'm going to get some too.
Yeah.
And
that
also kind of spreads it around a little bit. So,
well, we continue to still see a small market for new houses.
There is nothing available.
And I read in a trend, that office space is people who sell office space because of the trend now to have Zoom meetings.
Home office, yeah.
Home office, that the available office space, there's plenty of it.
You can be anywhere if you need office space. Yes, there is plenty.
People are talking about converting office space to apartments and condos.
Yeah. Is that right?
Because there's a dire lack of apartment space.
Yeah, there's no living space. So, yes, that's definitely a consideration, converting old office buildings that are empty or have, ghost town staffs in them.
Yeah.
Convert that to apartments and then.
Yeah. It's strange that AI and or our fast-changing world of science, I suppose I call it, industry, is really changing our culture.
Yeah.
So much.
So fast, yeah.
So much.
And is it in a positive way? Oh, I don't know.
Oh.
Technology?
Yeah. Technology. So well, I
know. It's making people more autistic.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, I don't know. I just...
How many phone numbers can you remember?
I can...
How many
just the ones I used to dial before I had a cell phone.
Correct.
Still stuck in my brain, but anything else, forget it.
Like, I can remember my deceased aunt's phone number.
Yep,
oh,
same.
My God.
I can remember the phone number for my house.
Let me see if I can remember.
Yeah, my childhood best friend's phone number is still in my mind.
36772.
If I had to call Bob, we'd be in trouble.
Yeah, yeah. Well, can you remember? Okay, remember your growing up phone number.
860-741-3325.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Rick?
My childhood phone
your
number?
Your childhood phone.
Oh, yeah,
phone.
I remember it.
What is it?
Yeah, 562-2546.
There you go.
Republic 28757.
Republic.
Republic. Do you believe this?
Wow. See, it Republic. Used to be just 22546.
22546.
Do you think, I mean, like, do you remember? You guys don't remember when our phone numbers had names attached?
No.
Absolutely not. No.
No.
I can't remember.
The only time I remember is even before the first two digits were in it, like the 56.
Ah. Chickabee was Lyceum.
Lyceum.
E-U-M. Lyceum.
Public Lyceum.
Lyceum. I don't understand that. I mean, and who was it Alexander Graham Bell that put that together for us? I don't know. It's so, I have no idea. But isn't that strange that we remember? Peter, you remember your childhood telephone number?
Yep, 783-1882.
783-182. Wonder if we called that right now.
Who's going to answer?
Who's going to answer? Shall we try?
Let's try. Hi, we're on the radio. Who are you, and how did you get Pete's phone number?
I wonder. Should I try?
Oh, my mom gave it up. So
would that be a wrong thing to do?
I mean, I don't think anyone's going to answer with the advent of caller ID and all the things when it says a stranger is calling. No one picks up their phone.
Right. I'm just going to...
Bob's going to dial your phone number, Peter.
No. I'll call my own just because I want you to stay out of it. I mean, I don't want... I don't want you... Are we doing anything FCC laws are saying no to?
Can we get kicked off the radio for this? Yes, we can.
All right, so let's see.
Not just for this.
Republic. 7-3...
Republic. Two, Republic. Eight. You look like you're calling a 900 number over there. That's not going to do anything without an area code.
Oh, it's calling, though. Look.
Speakerphone.
The number. Server unreachable.
Yeah.
Server unreachable. Do I have to?
You need all 10 digits now. You can't just dial 7 digits.
You can't do just what?
There's no such thing as local calling anymore. You're calling from your mobile device.
Right.
757. Okay. Here we go.
Now you do speakerphone. All right, Bob's calling us.
I mean, it could be a dead phone number now.
Now we're like a morning show.
You mean they've retired my
making prank phone calls?
This is not working.
Oh.
Uh oh.
What are you gonna say?
It could be a dead phone number.
Not in service.
They've retired my phone number.
Yeah, well, that's what happens.
Is that a
No one has landlines anymore. Can you assign a landline phone number to a cellular telephone?
Yeah, I don't know. January 19th, 1938 was really important. Do you know why?
I don't know why.
Benny Goodman's orchestra appeared at Carnegie Hall.
Oh.
And it was the first time a non-classical performer appeared at Carnegie Hall. And you know who was in his band? Lionel Hampton.
Well,
Teddy Wilson, Gene Krupa, everybody that you could ever think of was in Benny Goodman's band. And what it did was it solidified jazz in the world of music. Ooh. Suddenly jazz was not on the outskirts, it was on the cutting edge or whatever. And so this was 1938, and big bands then suddenly started to take on a whole new meaning in jazz or big band music. So a
white guy culturally appropriated black music and brought it to the whitest stage in New York City.
Very good, Peter. Did you read that somewhere? Or did you make that up?
No, Bob. I understand both sides of the coin. I just don't agree with it.
Oh, all right. Okay. Yeah. No. So true.
I'm surprised you didn't call that out on Martin Luther King Day.
No, well, I didn't. But I know that the folks that he had, from Teddy Wilson to Lionel Hampton, Count Basie was in that as well. Count Basie. All of these people at Carnegie Hall, and we've got the tape of that actual whole show. You can hear it on where we're recording. You can go to YouTube and hear it. It's January 19th, 1938. This is Blue Skies, the Irving Berlin number, played by the Benny Goodman Orchestra.
Writing support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Greater Westfield Chamber of Commerce, the voice of business for the Greater Westfield communities. Informing, educating, advocating, the Chamber provides opportunities for members to make meaningful connections on local, regional, and state levels. For more information on the Chamber's many events, workshops, and programs, as well as the benefits of membership, visit westfieldbiz.org. The Chamber focuses on the most important economy,
yours.
Join me, Tina Gorman, each week from 6 to 8 a.m. for Wake Up Wednesday, when my guests and I discuss health, wellness, and lifestyle reimagined.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Oh my
God! Oh, you're so sweet. Bob Plass here, westfieldonweekends.com. Go to all that if you want to follow me on Instagram. I'm on Facebook, but you can also do Plass Bob at instagram.com. I'm always crazed with my musings. When you have a bad server in a restaurant, Jessica Martin, that's my guest. This is my guest here, Jessica Martin from Jessica Martin Realty. Jessica Martin Hives. No, yes. Martin Hives.
Martin Hives, yes.
Martin Hives. And from the world of realty to bees to books to drinking in bars and playing cards. This woman does it all. Yeah. And the gentleman sitting to Jessica's left,
right
on television. Are you? No, wait a minute. Jessica's right. Everybody else is left.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Stick
okay.
with that. Jessica's right. That's all that matters.
Yeah. Bob is sitting on your left.
Rick Barry of the Penguin Plunge. Consider going and or participating in the Penguin Plunge. Go to
or at least helping support the Amelia Park Children's Museum.
Yeah, very much important to our cultural life in our city.
Yes.
So, Jess.
Bob.
I asked Robert. You a question and I can't remember Robert? What the question was. I question? Yeah, Wobbert. Yeah.
Wobbert?
Was it an off-air question?
Was that Wobbert?
Oh, no. Oh, I wanted to tell you that we were talking about drinking and all that business. Do you know what happened in 1919 today?
No.
Prohibition started. Oh, yes.
Prohibition was in 1919
was
today.
It was a black day.
It was a sad day.
This was history. The day that everybody stopped drinking in the 20s.
Everyone. It was the day everyone was told to stop drinking.
Yes, true. Yes.
Yeah.
They worked around it. They worked around it.
Can you imagine? It's an interesting deal that they stopped drinking. Was it basically a temperance kind of thing that people thought that their morals were being
sure God, that's government trying to save us from ourselves, right?
Yeah
Well, it's the temperance movement.
It was the temperance movement. Yeah.
We blame women for that, right?
Yes.
And it opened up the world.
Well, they were the driving force behind that one, right?
Oh, I think they were.
It was like moms and grandmoms.
Yes. Of course.
No.
In fact, we still have a monument here in Westfield.
We have a whole park now.
The Temperance Park, the Temperance Fountain.
Yeah.
Yep.
You know what they're trying to do with the Temperance Park now?
What's that?
Because it was run by women. I mean, that was a real women's issue back then. They are now creating a women's history park out of the Temperance Park in Westfield, don't you? It's a terrific idea. Strangely enough, the Roman Empire began today. This is the day that Caesar was proclaimed the emperor of Rome.
Oh.
And they got rid of the republic and became an emperor.
Empire.
And it's so interesting that the Roman Empire died, okay, with this dictatorship. Prohibition led to the mafia. And all the black market dealings and all of that.
Yeah,
I think prohibition caused more problems than it solved.
That's likely true. Yes.
You know, at any rate, it's a real interesting day. You are a great reader.
Thank you. Yes, I try.
What books have you read? Yet, why am I talking like some kind of strange? All
I feel like
sudden,
we're on the couch. We're behind.
Why? It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood.
Yes.
Well, tell me what books you just finished a Stephen King book.
Finish Stephen King's latest, Holly. Yes, I was just a little bit disappointed that it was so political. He has a lot to say, and he does usually plug those things, his opinions, into things, but usually not in such a forward way. It was really like being beat over the head with COVID and Trump and all the things that he found wrong with everything that happened.
Right.
So I was a little disappointed in that because I do read to kind of escape. So it felt like too much too soon. Still great characters and still a great story. And for Stephen King, not a super long book. So if you followed Holly through the Mr. Mercedes series or any of the short stories or The Outsider, which is a really big book, it's a continuation of her character. She's a fabulous character. So I would still say read it if you've read those other books.
Yeah.
But if you have any COVID or Trump triggers, maybe don't read it.
Well, I wonder. Yeah, you say that it's COVID.
Yeah.
You think it's too you know, it's too early to do a COVID movie. There have been some movies based on COVID or books based on COVID. And quite honestly,
I don't
want to read them.
We lived it.
We lived it.
Why would I want to read about something that was so terrible and still lingering effects, you know?
No, it's sort of like September 11th. Right after that, there are all these books. I have yet to see a movie on September 11th. I'm tempted. I haven't read. There are some really good September 11th novels out now. I don't know. Have you read any of those?
No.
You will not read them.
No, I like to. I'm not against the exist. Like I'm glad people take the time to do those things.
Right.
For the people who do want to consume them, but it is like my reading is my escape, and I want to not feel terrible. So I tend to choose things that aren't devastatingly sad. And I feel like just reading anything about that is not going to make me feel good. So
I'm reading book three of the Louise Penny Three Pines mystery series.
Is this a new series from her? Or is
No. Yeah, okay. It's the old one with Inspector Gamache and all of that.
Got it.
And I am enjoying she writes really well, and every book seems to get better.
Okay.
So, and there are 17 of them, so I got a long way to go.
Oh, boy. And you're committed? You're going to go right through the...
James has done it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to, you know, and then I'm probably not going to read another... Inspector. Yeah. I'm not going to read another mystery series. There are so many other, but I got so many books to read.
It's a lot.
I actually started one this week. It's called You Will Also Like. That's the name of the book. You Will Also Like. And it's about choice in a world where we have so many choices.
Yes, it's and exhausting.
What do we like and why we like it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And for instance, what's your favorite color?
Green.
What's your favorite color?
Blue.
What's your favorite color?
Oh, I think green. What makes it your favorite color?
I'm just attracted to it.
What is it? What is it about? Why? I ask you why.
Why do you like green?
Why do you like it?
I don't know. But
have you ever stopped liking green?
I don't think so.
Do you wear a lot of green?
I wear some green, more on the darker variety than the brighter variety. But I do tend to buy things that are green to wear.
Uh-huh.
And also, like, when it comes to other things, like my toothbrush is always green. So when you can pick any color of toothbrush, I will always choose the one with the green handle.
You're kidding me.
Yeah, it's really weird. People are weird. But
Peter, what is your color of choice?
Usually it's blue.
Blue. Blue. So you and Rick have blue. All right.
Do you have blue toothbrushes, though?
Yeah. Do you have
blue? Mine is blue, yeah.
Yes. See? Yes, actually, mine is, too.
That's how you know your favorite color. Check your toothbrush, and then you'll know what your favorite color is.
Oh, my God. I usually try to pick a toothbrush that is so different than James that he won't, you know, be scrubbing the toilet with it. Or maybe he will. I have no idea. But... The book is by Tom Henderson, and he had written a book about why we drive, why we're such bad drivers and all of that stuff. And so this is a good second version of it. And it really says, well, he comes to the conclusion, I think. I haven't finished the book. I got a long way to go in it. But the idea that throughout a lifetime, your changes are based on lots of things, including how you feel at the moment or how what others think about it, okay? Are you more likely to choose something that no one else likes or would you choose something that everyone likes?
I'm more likely to be rebellious and pick something that other people would not likely choose.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah.
Have you seen my sweater?
Oh my God. Yes. I can't. I'm allowed to touch this woman. Yeah. Yeah. This sweater that you are wearing, a hairy sweater.
So I think this is a mohair sweater. Yes.
Is that what it is?
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
I used to have a mohair tie.
Yeah. Like
oh my God. And you want to touch it for some reason.
Hair is off.
Yeah. 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 It looks like a dog that is molting.
See?
A dog that's molting?
Molting.
No one else would choose this.
Yeah, no. But the idea of why we choose something is based on lots of things. Do you choose something because you're in a group, and in order to be part of that group, you need to like this?
Mm-hmm.
Why do you have... This is a good question. Do you have the same breakfast every day?
Yes.
Do you diversify your breakfast at all?
I mean, very rarely, but...
Do you have the same dinner every day?
No. Dinner will shake up, but breakfast, we have different versions of the same thing every day.
So there have been studies about why people have the same breakfast every day, and yet at night they
shake up the dinner?
They shake up the dinner. Why? Why? You know, the more we are exposed to something, the more we like it. Supposedly.
Okay.
We assimilate. For instance, will you go to see Barbie because everyone else is going to see it?
I still haven't seen Barbie, so not.
Okay.
Not
will you right now? I'm trying to see every film that's been nominated, so I have an opinion.
Oh yeah, no, that's a thing. I tend to avoid things that are wildly popular to my detriment. So even when Harry Potter was a craze and everyone was waiting for the last book to come out, like I refused to participate. I was like, everyone's going crazy over that. And then finally I went for it and I was like, oh, I was missing something. This is wonderful. So
yeah. For you, Rick, what about you? What in terms of your likes and dislikes?
That's a hard question. You know?
Yeah.
It really is.
Is there anything that you love now that you didn't like at one point? Like Grateful Dead?
Yeah.
No,
actually, I've always liked the Grateful Dead.
Oh, okay. But
I can tell you one thing I do hate. And that I can't say hate. Hate, it's just a strong word.
Yeah.
It's just people. People in general. I have learned to dislike people. And I have learned learned that my alone time is phenomenal.
Interesting.
Oh.
Even if I'm sitting at the bar by myself, it's okay. I have no problem with that.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I will talk to people because most places I know I know most people in there. I will talk to them. But sitting by yourself or even just that time by yourself is
loving your life, your quiet time.
Right.
Now, has that changed since you were a kid?
I grew up in a house with 11 people. Oh, what do you think? 11 people, one dog, and like four cats.
Yeah.
I enjoy my alone time. I get plenty of it.
Yeah. For instance, I hated pears when I was growing up.
And you love them now. I was going to use food as an example, too. Yeah. Like, I love olives. I would never eat an olive 10 years ago. I would keep those olives away from me, and now I love them.
Yeah.
That's strange, because most of the food that I didn't like as a kid, I still do not like.
Yeah. Really?
Are you open to trying?
But I will eat hummus. I will eat hummus now. I never used to eat hummus.
Hummus?
Yes, because it never looks appetizing.
It's very beige. Yeah. It's very beige.
It looks like your food is beige.
It looks like spackle.
Unless you put saffron or something in it.
It looks like wall spackle.
Yeah. Wall spackle. I'm trying to think of something that I am getting tired of because I've had too much of it. I think it's. I think for you, the idea of people, you've had too much of it. I mean, I'm now able to turn the television set off after 7 o'clock at night. Before, I couldn't.
Oh.
This idea of getting hooked on something right now, I get fearful of that because I know that if I like something, I want to like it more. I want that dopamine to kick in. And this book talks about the idea of that rush that we get when we like something. And if you get that rush over and over,
that adrenaline,
you got to keep.
Bob's chasing a dragon.
He's chasing the dragon. Yeah, the dopamine dragon.
Yeah. So at any rate, my book that I'm recommending is You Will Also Like.
You Will Also Like This.
Yeah.
You Will Also Like.
So if you want to read about what we like and what we don't like, do that as well. And I am about to begin reading, I think I'm going to begin the Ken Follett prequel.
Those are big books, too. Yeah.
Prequel to Pillars of the Earth.
Yeah, okay.
It's called Evening and Morning.
That's newer, right? That's one of the newer releases? It's a prequel.
Yeah, it's a newer one. Yeah. So I'm about ready to delve into a long book.
All right.
Yeah. Reading as a kid for you, you're not a great... You don't like reading, or do you like reading?
Oh, I do like reading. I just don't have a lot of time to do it.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So I'm always busy doing something.
I get it.
Whether it's working, volunteering.
What else?
Yeah.
Playing cards?
No, not playing cards. No.
Hey, you know whose birthday it is today? One of my favorite people in the world is Lynn.
Me? No, mine's not until February.
This ought to make everyone laugh. Lin-Manuel Miranda is so great, but it's also Ethel Merman's birthday today.
So who did you mean? We're gonna have to decide which one is your favorite.
Yeah. Tell me who would I rather listen to, Ethel Merman or Lin-Manuel?
I hope it's Lin-Manuel because he's so fabulous.
Yes.
Do you know who Ethel Merman is, Rick?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
Could you tell me something about Ethel Merman that I may not know?
That you may not know? No, I probably don't. You know more about. I know who she is.
Yeah.
I just.
Well, what do you do? What do you know? Describe her to me.
She was a singer from what, the 40s?
Yeah. 50s, 60s,
50s?
70s, 80s.
Was she?
Late 70s.
Okay.
She had a disco album.
She did? Yeah. I didn't realize she had a disco album.
Oh yeah. She had a disco album.
I always remember her as that kind of high, not screechy, but more or less jazzy.
Distinct
voice, yes.
She had a very distinct voice. Would you
call it scratchy?
It was loud.
It was loud. Yeah, she was boisterous.
She was in the movie. Yeah. Well, isn't there a big scene in the movie Airplane where somebody is pretending to? Oh no! What is it? It's a Mad Mad World where somebody thinks that they're Ethel
Merman.
She says that this woman in there is saying that she thinks she's Ethel Merman, and then it's a mental institution, and it turns out to be Ethel Merman.
Actually, Ethel Merman. Yeah.
Well, you got to hear her. This is her singing. This song was written for her, incidentally, by George Gershwin. I Got Rhythm was written for Ethel Merman. So this is Ethel Merman singing George Gershwin's I Got Rhythm. You'll notice the long notes. This will make you laugh. Peter?
All the the day. Happy with my lot. How do I get that way? Look at what I've got. I got rhythm. I got music. I got my man. Could ask for anything more. I got daisies in green pastures. I got my man who could ask for anything more. An old man's trouble, say I don't mind him, but you won't find him round my door. I got starlight and I got sweet dreams. I got my man who could ask for anything more, who could ask for anything more.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Saturdays were made for polka. Tune in to the Polka Jammer Network starting at 6 a.m. and Polka Hall of Famer Billy Bellina breakfast at BB at 8:30.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Wow, it is Tuesday, January 16th, 2024, and counting. And I am here with Jessica Martin Jessica Martin Realty and Rick Coles and Peter...
What?
Peter Barry?
Rick Coles.
Huh?
Hey, I got an announcement to make. Rick, meet your father.
Wait a minute. I'm older than him.
Oh. Oh.
That's confusing.
That's so confusing.
Somebody play the Back to the Future music.
Yes.
Oh, my God. Today is National Nothing Day.
What?
I got nothing.
Do nothing?
What? I don't know what it means. National Nothing Day.
Nothing Day.
Yeah.
National
yeah.
Nothing Day.
Here's what I say about that.
Who nominated?
Oh my God. Who cares? The hell cares?
Yeah. It's also National Fig Newton Day. I can live without Fig Newtons. They were the one cookie that
it's
I didn't.
Cookie.
I didn't.
It's not a cookie.
Oh, it's not a cookie.
Newtons
it's
are fruit cake. And cake.
Wait, what? What?
That's their whole advertising.
What is that? What is
it? It's not a cookie, Mother. Newtons are fruit and cake.
Is that right?
It's not a cookie. It's a fruit, Newton.
I had no idea.
Stop it. Just don't call it a cookie. You can keep going. I'm sorry to interrupt.
No. Fig Newton is not a... It's a cake.
It's a cake.
Do you consider a Fig Newton...
Fruit Newton.
Is this a drinking game?
Oh, and there's both. It's Fig Newton, and they also have a Fruit Newton. There's two, so.
Oh, there are Fig Newtons and now Fruit Newtons.
For a while there were.
The Fig ones are the best.
The Fruit Newton sounds to me like a fruitcake.
Probably has strawberry jam or raspberry jam in it instead of the Fig.
I don't know. I'm not crazy about them.
No, all right.
I'm not crazy about them, although they're a good sugar substitute. Excuse me for spitting.
That's true.
Yeah. Sugar substitutes. And that goes along with Sugar Awareness Week.
Sugar Awareness.
How many sugars do you take in your coffee?
Zero.
No Peter?
Sugars.
Zero.
I was like, wait, don't you know how we all take
coffee? Yeah, I use two.
Two sugars.
Two sugars, yeah.
I don't know. But that don't sounds use, to me I, like a lot of sugar.
But I don't use cream.
Bob's coming
oh,
down.
Oh, you don't use
but cream? But I use, no, I drink it black with two sugars.
Uh-huh.
So there's no...
Black, no sugars.
No dairy.
No black.
No sweetened cream. No.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Are you a sugar judger? Being judgy about sugar over here?
People that just... Have you seen that where somebody has got their coffee and they've got, what do they call that kind of sugar dispenser that you pour the sugar? Uh-huh. I don't know if they still use those.
It's like a spout.
Oh, yeah, spout. Yeah, yeah. What do they call those things? That
sugar.
It's a sugar dispenser.
Yeah.
That is filled with sugar, and you what? It's like a
glass jar.
It's a glass jar
with a hole in the top of it.
What do they call that?
Sugar holder.
A sugar dispenser.
No, they must. There's another name for it.
Get on the duck.
But we used to have those then. But I remember at the restaurant I used to work at, we had those were all at every at the diner I used to work with. Sugar. They were there. And you would see these people pour sugar like it was the Niagara Falls of sugar coming out of this spout into their coffee.
It's like gritty and you're just crunching it in your teeth.
Yeah. My father used to have it that way. I loved the taste as a kid. But I don't know. Does sugar make your teeth grit?
I don't like that.
Oh, yeah. No, not at all.
I don't eat a lot of sugar. No.
All right. Now it's time for a game.
Oh, no.
Yes. Oh, no. This is the who would I'm going to tell something, and you're going to ask questions and then judge whether it is a lie or not.
Oh. All right.
The man in the elevator of my boyfriend's building in New York thought I was somebody other than who I actually was.
Okay. Someone famous? Is it time to start questioning you?
Yes. Now you can start questioning me.
The password is.
Right? What is the password? Did they think you were someone famous?
No.
Did they think you were a relative?
Yes.
So a sibling of your boyfriend.
A sibling of my boyfriend.
Yes.
No, cousin? That's not. No.
Luke, I am your father's brother's car
salesman. This guy thought that I was my boyfriend's father.
Father!
I am not your father.
Did you used to date younger, Bob?
No. Well, this young man, he who shall. You ever have one of those spouses or the boyfriends that you call he who shall be nameless?
Voldemort. Yes.
Yes. You have one?
No.
Well, I have a girlfriend like that. But
oh
yes.
Yeah. Oh, she who was. Well, yes. Okay. So this was a boyfriend of mine who I told the elevator man that I was his father.
He actually told the elevator man.
Yeah.
The elevator man did not come to that on his own.
Yeah, no, okay. No. He told the elevator man that was his father because he didn't want the elevator man to think that he was dating. And the elevator man didn't even know that this guy was gay.
That was my follow-up question, was because he was not out, or what was the situation?
No, he who shall...
Why would he choose father of all the things? That's such a weird thing to say. It just cousin. Makes it weird.
Well, could have said cousin.
Yeah, so every time I got into the elevator, he said, well, so-and-so isn't here right now.
Yeah.
And I would have to then say, "Well, the reason why I
when this, Bob came, the cloaking device came on.
Yeah, well, when I went to the apartment, I had a key to the apartment.
Yeah.
And he didn't want the elevator man to think that he had given a key to a boyfriend,
to a lover.
And so, therefore, I became the father, and so I had to act like this guy's father. Even when we were in the elevator together,
that's very.
I had to act
Bob, like. Bob, why didn't you just get off on a higher floor and take the stairs down?
Were you old enough to have actually been his father? Were you 20 years older than this person?
No, I was 6 years older. I was seven years older. Let me say 7 years old.
Why did he choose father? Can you explain that?
He thought I looked older than him.
But again, you could.
He was shorter than I was.
You could have been giving him singing lessons. He could have made up anything.
Yeah.
The fact that he chose father is very strange.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Rick, you have a question on this one?
No.
Do you think it's true?
Yeah, I think it's true.
I feel like you can't.
You think
that
it's
up.
True?
Yeah, I will think it's true. Yeah.
I'm gonna go with false because you're ridiculous. That's ridiculous.
Peter, you want to take a stab at this one?
I think it's a bold-faced lie.
That is the truth.
Stop it. Good job, Rick.
Yeah,
put the cloaking device on.
Absolute truth. And it was.
It's,
so,
I'm not saying you look old, Bob, but
no, 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 no.
Make it up.
I couldn't figure it out, and so consequently, I had to think old.
Yeah.
You know.
And pretend to be a parent of an adult. That's very strange.
Oh my gosh! I did have another boyfriend at one point who told I was very. He was like 15 years younger than me. Maybe let's say 12 years younger. I do have my limits.
Okay.
Okay. And he told his mother that I was, because I was about the same age as his mother.
Okay.
So he told his mother that I was more his age.
Got it.
So when we had dinners at her house, we would sit and I would have to, always, when she asked me a question about, well, what was it like when you went to school?
Yeah, you have so to try so. To be like,
I have to think of myself as a younger person.
Went to school, yeah.
I don't know which was harder, pretending to be
younger?
that guy's father or...
Pretending to be younger than you were.
Yeah, yeah. Do you think I should have dumped the guy who wanted me to be his father? He did not want me to be his father.
Unless it was part of some kind of kink, then yes, there's no reason to pretend to be his father.
That's a duh moment, Bob.
Isn't it really? Yeah. Isn't that? Yeah, well, I thank God I'm
You're
ended
past
up,
that, huh?
I'm past that.
Yeah.
I married somebody who was very close to my age, yes. So we both are in the same age group. How's that with you and Sean?
Oh, we have a 7-year gap, which doesn't seem like much at our ages now. But, I mean, when we met, I was 23 and he was 30, which is a big difference in age.
And did he – so was there any pretending about you being older or he being younger?
No.
How about you and Michelle?
We're 5 years apart.
5 years
yes.
apart. And there was no pretending. It was okay. Five years is okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we've only been together for the last 10 years, so it's okay.
All right. How about you, Peter?
What, the was age difference?
Yeah. Was there ever an age difference that you had to lie about?
No.
Never?
Nope.
No.
I always try to keep it within 5 to 10 years tops.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Anything longer than that, it's a generational issue.
Oh, it's a total generation issue. I really cared, and I still care about that young man who was much younger than I. And it was not a case of my being attracted. I don't know why. You know, you often, I got to read in the book why I'm attracted. This book I'm reading, you will also like.
You will also like.
Why I would want somebody who was in a different generation. Huh. I always felt as if I were denying part of myself, in a sense, in conversations.
Yeah, that seems legitimate.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's the game today.
That's the game. Wah, wah. Rick wins, though. Exciting.
Rick, you've won the trip.
Can I just say something?
Yes.
I'm confused.
Yeah, what?
The whole thing. I'm just confused.
You were confused that I was pretending to
be
the
father?
No, the whole game.
The whole
Have you never seen that show? Why Would I Lie to You?
To tell the truth.
No, it's called Why Would I Lie to You? Oh my gosh, you gotta watch it. It is so funny on YouTube. Why Would I Lie to You is the name of it. Uh-huh. It's from Britain, and they lie. You have to guess the lie, and etc. I recommend.
Here's what I think about that whole segment.
What?
Wilson, I turn up the sound.
He hated that segment.
Where are you going?
All right, Peter. Peter, tell us either a lie or a truth, and we'll try to discern whether it's a lie or a truth. Go ahead.
Well, we'll have to do that for the next.
Yeah, we're almost
done.
Oh,
well, how many?
We got about 5 minutes.
Oh, we got about.
That's enough time.
That's plenty of time.
We got plenty of time. We can come up. All right, Rick, you want to come up with?
I thought Peter was going to.
Peter is going to. Peter.
Okay. Let's see.
Yeah. Toot.
Okay. I attended the last man launch from the United States, and I attended the next man launch from the United States. One in 2011 and one in 20.
All right. So what is the launch of what?
The last manned launch was STS-135, which was a shuttle.
Uh-huh.
And then the next manned launch is a gap of, I think it's about 9 years.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Was the launch of a Falcon 9 rocket, DM-2, Bob and Doug, to the International Space Station.
Okay. So you.
Is that a lie or is that the truth?
Well, we could ask another question or two.
Okay.
Did you attended? Where was the first one?
They were both from the exact same spot.
And how old were you at the time?
How old was I at the time?
The first one, and how old were you at the last one?
Stalling.
I was
stalling.
40, I think.
40, and then you're not, and now.
And then, yeah.
Did you drive to the both of them?
Yes.
And did you have access to both of them?
No.
You didn't. You had access to only one of them.
Yes.
You had access to the most recent, the one that you first went to, you crashed.
No.
In a manner of speaking. No.
No.
No. What? What?
Is it true or not?
Is it? I was going to say, how do we, asking the questions, trust the answers if the game is about lying?
The game is about lying. The idea here is that the liar needs to ask the answer the questions, and we have to figure out whether they're making the story up as we go along.
Got it. I think Peter is making it up. I think he knows about these things, and he's got the good timeline, but I think he didn't go to both.
Yeah, it seems like there is. I think you want to tell us that you went to one and you didn't go to the other, which is not as great a lie as I would want it.
You wanted a bigger lie, probably.
I want a bigger lie.
But it could also be the truth. Do we get Rick to weigh in on this?
Is it the truth or not?
I know he's been to a number of launches. I just can't remember which ones they were.
Yeah. He's been to so many launches that
it's going to say that it is. Not the truth.
We are going with the idea that it's not the truth.
Vote. You're all wrong.
Ah!
It was the truth.
It was the truth. STS-135, I attended as a guest of Channel 40 on press credentials. So I was there close up and personal.
Right.
And then DM-2 was during COVID in 2020. And Kenny and I did that one from the balcony of a bed and breakfast in Titusville. And I witnessed both launches.
I would have loved for you to say, I witnessed the launch of a satellite launch from the porch of a bed and breakfast. Or like, I can see Alaska from my roof.
Bob, we had a drought. We had a drought of almost a decade where we didn't launch a single human into space from United States soil.
Oh.
Wow!
And my
this was
God.
The return to space. That was the thing. The last shuttle launch was the last time we put humans up from United States soil.
Right.
And SpaceX DM-2 was the first manned mission of their Dragon capsule.
Wild, 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 wild! Wow, wow. Well, I
have video to prove that I was at both.
Okay. All righty. Very, very good. Did we lose or did we win on that one?
You lost.
We lost.
Did the lose? Does the listeners lose or did they win?
Unanimous losers, and I think that we're also.
I'm surprised I fooled you guys all.
Yeah, yeah. Well, see, that's the game. Now, I want you to this is your homework for all of you. Go home, YouTube. Why would I lie to you and watch? And you're going
to
get hooked.
The American version was called To Tell the Truth.
No, it wasn't. Well. It's different. Yes. It's different. It's a different game.
Different game.
Different game. You'll see. You'll see. Hey, everybody, do you know what being California sober is?
California sober means you're on weed, I bet.
How did you know that?
We've been talking about it all day?
Yes, exactly.
California Sober is the song, and because it's mocktail day.
Yes.
Okay. They don't have mocktails in California. They're sober because California Sober means. And guess who's singing this?
Who's
Billy Strings and somebody else.
Billy Strings and somebody else. I don't
who's
know.
Who's the other? Who's the most name?
Willie Nelson.
No, most name the most.
Oh, Willie Nelson.
Willie Nelson.
I'm disappointed in myself.
Willie Nelson, California sober. Everybody, maintain your sobriety out there, and hope you have a good day. See you next time. Always good to have Jessica Martin on from Jessica Martin
Thank
Realty.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Yeah. Thank you. Rick, I'll see you soon.
Yes.
Here we go. California sober, everyone.
Well, I used to like to ramble with my good time friends and neighbors. Now I find I'd rather lie awake in bed. And I don't get to act and mean when I keep my buzzes clean and keep the hard stuff in the whiskey from my head. Well, I guess that's just the trouble when you're always seeing double and the lines are getting twice as hard to see. I've had years I don't recall, but I'm told I had a ball, at least somebody did who looked a lot like me. So I'm California sober, as they say, and lately I can't find no other way. I can't stay out and party like I did back in the day, so I'm California sober, as they say.
I'll pick it, Willie.
Pills to get their thrills, and they love their liquor down in New Orleans. Maybe far out New York minute, sugar cane will fit the bill, but in no time flat, you're out of what you need. The old crew don't get together anymore these days, much ever, and some went straight and some went straight to jail. Now they're busy posting vids and just trying to raise their kids to the raising holy hell and posting bail.
Well, I'm California sober, as they say, and lately I can't find no other way. I can't stay out and party like I did back in the day, so I'm California sober, as they say. Once again, when that wagon passes by, I don't even bat an eye.